Good morning. I'm East Coast Pete. Today I'm going to have a look at Robbie Robertson, OC. He was born in 1943. He was only a child. His mom was a Native American Cayuga Mohawk. They lived on the Six Nations Reserve, not far from Toronto. It was there that he learned guitar from relatives. He often listened to R&B music on the radio on WKBW, Buffalo. In his early teens, his mom told him that his biological father was a professional gambler named Alexander Kligerman, who was killed in an auto accident at the age of 14. Robbie moved. He worked two summers with a traveling carnival and later at a freak show. These experiences were chronicled in a band song, Life as a Carnival. Rob's first band was Little Caesar and the Consuls in 1956. They played at teen dances. This led him to form Robbie and the Rhythm Chords in 57. After watching Forbidden Planet, he changed the band's name to Robbie and the Robots. The Robots became the Swades, and this was the band that Ronnie Hawkins heard and sat in with at the Hi-Fi Club in Toronto. Hawkins had his own band, the Hawks, and he hired Robbie to join his road crew. They became friends. After a time, Robbie was hired as a bass player for the Hawks, who were from Arkansas. Robbie switched over to lead guitar when that spot opened. Roy Buchanan was also a member of the Hawks and had an influence on Robbie. Levon Helm was the Hawks drummer, and he became friends with Robbie. In 1961, the Hawks added Rick Danko, Richard Manuel, and Garth Hudson. In 1964, the Hawks left Ronnie Hawkins to strike out on their own. They were tired of Hawkins' rockabilly. They wanted to play blues and soul. At first, they were the Levon Helm Sextet, and they played the same circuit up the East Coast and into Canada as they'd done as the Hawks. Robbie was writing most of the lyrics for the singles. They somehow found the time to record. And then Bob Dylan contacted the Hawks through Albert Grossman. Dylan wanted to hire Robbie to tour. Robbie turned him down, but he and Helm did play two shows with Dylan, one in Forest Hills, New York, and one at the Hollywood Bowl in Los Angeles. This led to Dylan hiring the entire band for a U.S. tour at the end of 1965. These shows were always in two parts. The first half was what Dylan had become known for, that is, acoustic guitar, harmonica, and vocals. Folk music, but Dylan's own style of it. The second half was electric with the Hawks, whom Dylan referred to as the band. This was more similar to his stuff, the stuff he had done before he had encountered fame, namely country blues. No less serious, but still perhaps more fun. Fans perceived Dylan's move to rock as a betrayal of their folk values. Hadn't they made him their reigning prince of the 60s folk revival? How dare he play a Strat? Levon Helm left the tour. He couldn't understand all the boos. But Dylan didn't care for the purest folkies. His protest songs had only made their generation worse, he thought, not better. So Bob had no strictures on his art. Been there, done that, so to speak. The tour was extended to 1966 all over the planet. The reaction was varied, but when they were booed, Dylan was more and more pleased, probably because he hated apathy. This wasn't apathy. Was Bob Dylan the first punk? These shows were released as the Bootleg Series, Volume 4. Bob Dylan, live in 66, the Royal Albert Hall concert. This was the infamous Judas show, when a fan called out Judas in reaction to the electric set. It was poignant and a turnover point in history. The dawning of the 60s, 6 years too late? Maybe. But nothing has ever been the same since that moment. D.A. Pennypacker filmed it, produced the documentary Eat the Document. That's the one, you know, with the signs. Dylan released his Blonde on Blonde double album, Robbie. Hey, remember Robbie? He was on the sessions. Dylan got hurt, broken neck from a motorcycle accident, and he and the band took time to heal at Big Pink, a house in Woodstock, New York. As usual, Bob got to places before anyone else, and the first Woodstock festival happened in 2.5 years. 3 years without Dylan, by the way. Notably, where was he? He was avoiding the droves of long-haired peaceniks tearing up Yasgur's farm and his front yard. The recordings made at Big Pink were released as the Basement Tapes, and Levon Helm returned in 67. Robbie's guitar style had evolved to become more supportive of the music. He gave up flash and lengthy lead noodling. Dylan was recuperating. His next album would be John Wesley Harding, and Bob asked Robbie to help flesh out the songs, but when Robbie heard the tapes, he told Bob that he should leave the music as it was. Such was the maturity that Robison had attained by then. The time spent with the Dylan Band had also evolved the band into the sound that they became known for in their own right. And all the members of the band contributed lyrics and music that would be recorded and released over the next years. Albert Grossman got them signed to Capitol Records. And the music from Big Pink was the initial result. And here are the songs. 1. Tears of Rage. by Dylan and Manuel. This is like coming home. 2, The Kingdom Come. This is a Robbie song. Robbie on lead vocals. And I see why. 3, In a Station. Manuel. Harpsichord? Where did they get one? 4, Caledonia Mission. That's another Robbie song. And Danko sings. Great tracks. 5, The Wait. Rob wrote that. Helm sings the lead. 6, We Can Talk. Manuel. Call and Response with Helm and Manuel. 7, Long Black Veil. Wilkin and Dill. Now I always thought this was a Dead song. Of course it was played by the Dead, but apparently they did not write it. Wilson and Dill did. 8, Chest Fever, Robbie. Best Track, Rob at His Best. Just Before She Leaves, She Receives. Lyric and a half there, huh? 9, Lonesome Susie. 10, This Wheel's on Fire. And I think that's what this is. In fact, I know that that's what this is. What a version. This was written by Dylan and Danko. 11, I Shall Be Released. That's, of course, a Bob Dylan song. What an amazing version, though. The Wait went on to become the band's best-known song, covered by Aretha Franklin, The Supremes, and The Temptations, to name just a few. The Nazareth reference was to the Martin Guitar Company in Nazareth, Pennsylvania. When you look inside a Martin guitar, there's a sticker that says Nazareth on there, and that's how Robbie came up with the idea for The Wait. Music from Big Pink got great reviews, and the band did not tour or promote it for a whole year. Why? It became a mystery, leading to speculation. But I think it was magical. What do you think? The album The Band was released in 1969. 1, Across the Great Divide, Manuel. The Birth of Americana. 2, Rag Mama Rag. That's Levon Helm. 3, The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down. Also Levon. 4, When You Awake, Robbie and Manuel. And 5, Up on Cripple Creek. This is Levon Helm. I guess you knew that. 6, Whispering Pines, Rob and Manuel. 7, Gemma Surrender, Rob and Helm. 8, Rockin' Chair, Manuel. 9, Lookout Cleveland, that's Danko. 10, Jawbone, Rob and Manuel. 11, The Unfaithful Servant, this is Danko. 12, King Harvest. Has Surely Come. This album, perhaps more than any other, began the genre known as Americana. Known as Americana. The band was the first rock act to be portrayed on the cover of Time magazine, incidentally. And here's the other albums. 3, Stage Fright. 4, Cahoots, Dylan, gave them when I painted my masterpiece. 5, Rock of Ages. 6, Moondog Matinee. Those are all covers. The band pulled up stakes in the East and moved to Malibu and had a reunion with Dylan and went on tour. Tickets for the shows made attendance records. 6 million requests for 650,000 tickets. Fans okay with the Strat now? Dylan and the band released Planet Waves in 1974. It went to number one in the United States. Before the Flood also went to number three in the U.S. in 1974. The band, on their own without Bob, released Northern Lights, Southern Cross in 75. And it went to number 26 in the U.S. It is a point of contention between Robbie and Helm about whether Robbie forced the band to split up, but Helm had gone back to Woodstock to build a studio, Danko signed a solo contract, and Richard Manuel injured his neck in a boating accident. Robbie stated that the band had agreed to play a farewell grand finale, and this became chronicled as The Last Waltz. One of the finest rock rockumentaries ever made. Guest artists include Muddy Waters, Ronnie Hawkins, Paul Butterfield, Dr. John, Bob Dylan, Eric Clapton, Van Morrison, Neil Diamond, Joni Mitchell, Neil Young, and more. Capitol wanted another album to complete the band's contract. This became Islands, which was mostly written by Robbie. Wanted to fulfill that contract. His music career, this is Robbie, after the band is a whole nother life. His awards and production of other artists is a long list of who's who in the entertainment industry. Plus, he released a bunch of solo records. Here they are. 1, Robbie Robertson in 87. 2, Storyville in 91. 3, Music for the Native Americans. This is a soundtrack in 94. 4, Contact from the Underworld of Red Boy in 98. 5, How to Become, is this an ad? No, don't give me no, oh, thank you. Oh boy, they scared me. I thought maybe the band threw an ad in there. How could they? They're not, no. 3 of them have died and gone, sadly. 5 is How to Become a Clairvoyant in 2011. And 6, Cinematic in 19. Richard Manuel died from heroin. Maybe something about a hanging. Suicide by hanging and heroin, maybe? I mean, if you saw what he looked like toward the end of his life, there was no doubt that he was strung out. Looked like a skull. And then Levon Helm died of cancer, and so did Rick Danko. And what a tribute Robbie did for the band recently, long after The Last Waltz. The love remains, Garth. The video documentary I'm referring to at the end there is called Once We Were Brothers. Thank you. do. Garth Hudson's still alive. Haven't heard from him lately, though. So, hopefully hear from Garth Hudson soon.